happened in Peru on September 12, 1992, which moved thousands of people across the world. Peasants from Nepal and India, Kurdish, Turkish and Iranian workers living in Germany, human rights lawyers, Maoist revolutionaries, members of parliament, musicians, professors and political refugees. People from all walks of life came together in protest. Why? Because on September 12th, Dr. Aymel Guzman, or Chairman Gonzalo, leader of the Communist Party of Peru, was captured by the Fujimori regime.
Flood warnings. Peru's capture of Shining Path guerrilla leader Aymel Guzman has not ended its 12 years of rebel violence. In Lima, gunmen killed a police officer and a bomb injured 8 commuters on the Pan-American Highway. Security forces remain on alert for further retaliation. Guzman's Sendero Luminoso and other Peruvian rebels are blamed for 25,000 deaths since 1980.
Dr. Guzman was immediately labeled World Public Enemy number 1. And lies about the PCP were broadcast endlessly in the US-dominated world media.
Do any of you doubt that a Shining Path military victory leading to governance of the country from Lima would have near genocidal consequences for at least large segments of the Peruvian population?
I think there's no doubt that it would be an extraordinarily brutal regime.
But millions of people in Peru and around the world knew the real brutality of the US imperialist themselves. And a massive campaign quickly arose in over 30 countries to defend the life of this revolutionary leader who defied the US rulers. The Peruvian regime had been desperate to capture Dr. Guzman to try to crush the advancing people's war in Peru.
Estamos ahora ofreciendo una recompensa, ya no de 250 mil soles, sino medio millón de dólares a quien entregue a Aymel Guzman Reynoso o a quien dé la información para su captura, vivo o muerto.
But the key player in this intensive manhunt was the CIA.
On the 12th of September, 1992, we were busy commemorating the death of Bantu Stephen Biko. It had been 15 long years since the death of one of the leading martyrs of the Azanian Revolution. We learned with shock and horror that our comrade, Dr. Aymel Guzman, was arrested and detained by Dincote in Peru. It was a body blow, we thought at the time, for the international proletariat. A few days later, however, we heard of the efforts by the International Emergency Committee to save the life of Aymel Guzman. We were inspired, tremendously inspired by this, because if there had been such a campaign in 1977, perhaps Stephen Biko would today be the president of Azania.
The threat to Dr. Guzman's life was great. Other communist leaders such as Sehar Sektar of Bangladesh, Charu Masundar of India, and Ibrahim Kapakaya of Turkey had been murdered soon after being captured. But this time, a few days after the capture of Dr. Guzman, an international emergency committee to defend his life was formed and set up an office in London. A call was put out and was soon signed by thousands of people. The first emergency bulletins were faxed out. Demonstrations were held around the world. Posters began appearing on the streets in India, Colombia, Italy, Germany, France, and Bangladesh. Peruvian embassies were taken by surprise as people showed up on their doorsteps in countries all across the world. Many people saw defending the life of Dr. Aymel Guzman as a concrete defense of the Maoist People's War led by the PCP. Many people joined the campaign to take a stand against the US imperialists who also make life hell in their own countries.
Chiquita,
who is Dr. Abimael Guzman? In the early 1960s, Dr. Guzman taught philosophy at a college in Ayacucho, in a very poor area in the Andean mountains. At this school, many peasants began to attend his lectures. By this time, Dr. Guzman had become a Maoist revolutionary. He went on to lead the struggle to reconstitute the Communist Party of Peru. In 1980, the Maoist People's War began, led by the PCP. Today, large sections of Peru are in the control of those people who for 500 years have had nothing. Revolutionary People's Committees have been formed by the PCP in many areas to govern the villages. Land belonging to landlords and the government has been confiscated and redistributed to the peasants. PCP has also gained influence in the city of Lima, especially in the shanty towns where more than 5 million people live. The US rulers are worried about this revolution winning and spreading throughout Latin America. When Dr. Guzman was captured, the US Congress voted unanimously to congratulate Fujimori. The US supplies extensive aid to Peru, and US military personnel have openly assisted Peru in its war against the PCP, sometimes under the disguise of the war on drugs. But even BBC TV has had to admit that labeling the PCP as narco-traffickers is wrong. It is the Peruvian government that depends on drug trade.
From the air, you can see clearly enough the landing strips which the drugs runners use to ferry the drugs out of the country. In Peru, only the army has the equipment and the organizational capacity to build and protect such airstrips.
The threat of US intervention against the people's war is real.
I don't think we should shrink from being engaged with this armed force despite all of its human rights problems. I think our record in El Salvador shows that engagement can reduce human rights abuses. And the training that the armed forces gets for counter-narcotics makes them a better force to go into the jungle and the valley. And that's where Sendero operates.
It's certainly bottom dollar in one thing, and that is that eventually we'll be involved.
Fujimori took power in Peru in 1990 with US support. His first economic measures, known as Fujishock, resulted in overnight inflation rates of up to 3,000%. Wages dropped by half. Unemployment skyrocketed. Half the people fell below the official poverty level, and over 80,000 children die each year from preventable poverty-related diseases.
In 1992, hay más de 15 millones de peruanos en extrema miseria. ¿Cuál es el problema ahí? El problema concreto es que ya no funciona el Estado. Por ejemplo, en estos 10 años o 10 años últimos, hay estadísticas muy serias que muestran que las grandes transnacionales han sacado más de 16 mil millones de dólares del país. 16 mil millones que van a los Estados Unidos y a los grandes países de Europa. En 1990 el señor Fujimori, que no es otra cosa que un títere abierto de los norteamericanos, dice que él resuelve totalmente el problema del hambre y la miseria. El hecho concreto es que ahora hay más miseria, más hambrientos que el año 85, que el año 90 y que el año 60. Entonces no hay salida económica y social para la población peruana mediante los mecanismos que está manejando el viejo Estado peruano.
With Fujimori in power, repression intensified. Peru led the world in the number of disappeared people 4 years in a row.
Esta imagen, difundida hace unos días por Televisión Española, es el más crudo testimonio de la desaparición de un estudiante por policías de servicio. La cámara graba lo que parece un episodio cotidiano de la lucha antisubversiva. La imagen es archivada y se utiliza días después en un reportaje sobre el trabajo de las fuerzas de orden. Carlos Rodríguez, 18 años, estudiaba medicina. Salió de su casa a las 9 de la mañana para no volver nunca más. Su padre se enteró de su detención viendo la televisión y se fue a buscarlo por las comisarías.
Lo meten a la cajuela, a la maletera del carro, el patrullero 27 y 58, y a la vuelta de una hora lo introducen al hospital como cadáver. Y yo tengo un conflicto en mi vida, porque yo a mis hijos les he enseñado que cuando yo no esté, ni esté su madre, frente a cualquier peligro, ellos ciegamente deberían correr a un policía. Y ahora me lo ha matado a mi hijo.
Meanwhile, the People's War was advancing throughout the country, including in the shanty towns of Lima.
In the last 2 years, Shining Path has worked successfully to move into the capital, Lima, where desperate poverty aggravated by the government's austerity measures has created fertile ground for the insurgents in the city's countless shanty towns. This is Raucana, the Shining Path's model settlement on the outskirts of Lima. Unlike neighboring slums, it has plenty of well water and almost no crime. They even raise their own animals for food, which is shared by all. It is well organized.
Cerca de un centenar de pobladores bloquearon la vía a las 6 de la mañana con cuanto objeto encontraban a su paso.
In 1981, police tried to evict people from the shanty town of Raucana.
Aquí en el kilómetro 9 de la carretera central, los pobladores de Raucana demostraron una organización casi militar que los diferencia de otros invasores. Vinagre y agua. Los hombres manejaban muy bien las ondas y las piedras. La gran mayoría llevaban mochilas. Todos eran expertos en el lanzamiento de piedras. Ni hombres ni mujeres temen a los gases lacrimógenos, que son sofocantes, ni se corren cuando escuchan la bala de los policías, que se limitaron a lanzar gases. Por momentos, el enfrentamiento se acentúa. Caen así las bombas molotov lanzadas por los infiltrados de Sendero contra la policía. Este mensaje escrito en la pancarta que porta la niña inocentemente nos hace recordar a una pancarta ayacuchana, donde Sendero convocaba a los soldados a desobedecer al general.
Esta es una de las zanjas construidas por los invasores para evitar el paso de los vehículos, especialmente los policiales. Esta zanja tiene una profundidad aproximada de 1,10 m, el largo 9 metros y el ancho supera el metro.
Aquí los hombres con el rostro cubierto se turnan cada 3 horas en la vigilancia. Hasta han construido torreones para tener mayor visibilidad en la vigilancia. Frente al torreón lateral han levantado barricadas al estilo militar. Todos están provistos de hondas. Otro grupo sube al cerro y desde allí monta guardia a pesar del frío. Hay vigías hasta en el muro perimetral del terreno. En las paredes, las pintas predican el combate. Raucana es un pueblo en pie de guerra.
On April 5, 1992, Fujimori realized that to continue to hold power in Peru, he had to make a self-coup. He suspended the Peruvian Congress and the Constitution.
Primero. Disolver temporalmente el Congreso de la República hasta la aprobación de una nueva estructura orgánica del Poder Legislativo, la que se aprobará mediante un plebiscito nacional.
The government was not winning this war against the people. This was why they were so determined to cut the head off the movement by capturing Dr. Guzman. But even after his capture, they were still not able to defeat the people's war. On September 24, several days after the arrest, the regime tried to humiliate Dr. Guzman before the world media. but Dr. Guzman turned the tables on Fujimori. His defiant speech was broadcast to the far corners of the world. It alerted and inspired people everywhere.
Unos piensan en una gran rosa. ¡Bueno! Decimos, sí, la doña. Es simplemente un recodo, nada más. Un recodo en el camino. El camino nada. Ya es que llegaremos nosotros y tumbaremos. Ustedes lo verán. Ustedes lo verán.
Within a few days of the capture, the International Emergency Committee organized a delegation of lawyers and others from France, Germany, and the US. They arrived in Lima and demanded to be observers of Dr. Guzman's trial. They met with Dr. Guzman's lawyer, Dr. Alfredo Crespo.
Aquí están presentes la doctora, una doctora de Francia y el doctor de Alemania. Son abogados que vienen como observadores independientes a ver cómo se desenvuelve este proceso.
Before Dr. Guzman was put in solitary confinement, he learned about the international campaign to defend his life. He sent his greetings and appreciation to the people around the world. Even before the trial, Fujimori had publicly pronounced Dr. Guzman guilty of treason. Discussion of the reinstatement of the death penalty began immediately. The authorities were trying to set the stage for the murder of Dr. Guzman inside the prison. He was tried by a military tribunal, and the generals who acted as his judges wore hoods to protect their identity from the people. The entire trial lasted only 3 hours. The IEC lawyers were not allowed in. They reported that the trial violated international and Peruvian laws and said it should be declared null and void. The slanderous news articles about the delegation meant that the world opposition to the Fujimori regime was felt throughout Peru. The delegates were accused of being terrorists. Heriberto Ocasio was actually called the psychiatrist of Saddam Hussein. But the people of Peru know how to interpret the reactionary Lima press.
And I met a young Peruvian woman in Germany at the conference who told me that she happened to have been in Lima, living in one of the shanty towns, when the first IEC delegation arrived. And they saw us on TV challenging the government. She said there were celebrations in the shanty town that night. And when she found out why I was, she hugged me and thanked me and others who've gone down to Peru. And she said, it was really profoundly heartening and strengthening to the people of the shanty towns that these international delegations of lawyers and others had gone down to defend Abimael Guzman.
Meanwhile, the international campaign was continuing to spread across the world. IEC put out a call for people everywhere to contribute one day's wages to the campaign. For over 1 year, the campaign has been sustained entirely by donations from ordinary people. In October, the second delegation arrived.
Dice cómo ocurrió todo.
Una segunda delegación de abogados del Comité Internacional de Emergencia de Defensa de la Vida de Abimael Guzmán, que llegó a Lima, fue expulsada por la División de Extranjería, luego de haber sido interrogados por la Dirección contra el Terrorismo y de haber permanecido detenidos durante un día.
Nosotros está acá por preguntar al presidente Fujimori de visitar los presos políticos, en particular a Abimael Guzman.
Within hours, while they were holding a press conference, they were arrested by DINCODE, the counterinsurgency police.
Poco después llegó la policía y se los llevó detenidos. Los extranjeros aparentemente no sabían que defender a miembros de Sendero Luminoso, y peor aún a Abimael Guzmán, es considerado como un delito.
Parece una cosa muy grave.
Muy grave, porque
no sé qué pasará.
Ellos no pudieron ver a los presos de Sendero Luminoso, pero sí conocieron los calabozos donde había estado Abimael Guzmán.
News of the expulsion traveled fast.
Komünist Partisi'nin başkanı, basında Aydınlık Yol diye adlandırılan Peru Komünist Partisi başkanı Abimael.
En Colonia, en la sede de la Federación de Trabajadores de Kurdistán, acto en defensa de Abimael Guzmán, jefe de la organización Sendero Luminoso, preso en Lima, Perú, por acusación de terrorismo y responsabilidad de la muerte de la de 25.000 personas. El abogado Reinhard Koch formó parte de la segunda delegación del Comité de Emergencia que pretendió en vano establecer contacto con el preso Abimael Guzmán en Lima en el mes de abril. Conferencia de prensa con dos miembros de esta segunda delegación del Comité Internacional. Reinhard Koch fue expulsado del Perú después de que la policía desarticuló una conferencia de prensa, lo apresó e interrogó. Para mí el doctor Abimael Guzmán es el líder de un movimiento de resistencia que se opone al régimen de Fujimori. El movimiento Sendero Luminoso tiene un gran respaldo de los intelectuales y de los campesinos y no es verdad que este movimiento sea genocida.
Und es stimmt einfach nicht, dass diese Bewegung einen Genozid ausübt.
Rakhip Tsarkolu, otro miembro de la delegación que visitó Lima pero no fue apresado, editor turco, considera que la lucha del Sendero Luminoso es similar a la del pueblo kurdo. Dijo que hay presos en Turquía, presos kurdos, que están en huelga de hambre por Abimael Guzmán. Existe el peligro de que el gobierno peruano imponga nuevamente la pena de muerte y que el Perú salga oficialmente de la Convención Americana de Derechos Humanos de San José, Costa Rica. Es un gran peligro para el pueblo peruano porque él perdería todas sus libertades y no solo se trata aquí de la pena de muerte. Recolección de dinero para sufragar el envío de una tercera delegación del Comité Internacional de Emergencia al Perú. Asisten al acto un centenar de kurdos, turcos e iraníes, en su mayoría trabajadores residentes en Alemania. El barrio de Mülheim, en Colonia, empapelado con la imagen de Abimael Guzmán.
Immediately after the capture, the Maoist parties and organizations, including the PCP, who are united in the revolutionary internationalist movement, issued a call: move heaven and earth to defend the life of Chairman Gonzalo. In his historic speech, Dr. Guzman upheld his revolutionary Maoist ideology. Political prisoners all over the world have expressed their support for Dr. Guzman. In prisons throughout Turkey, such as Buja prison and Urla prison, solidarity days were held inside the prisons. There has also been support from political prisoners in the US, such as Mumia Abu-Jamal, who is himself on death row, and Leonard Peltier of the American Indian Movement. Jose Maria Sison, the founding chairman of the Communist Party of the Philippines, has actively supported Dr. Guzman and the campaign.
Dr. Guzman and I have the same experience. I was arrested by the military agents of the U.S. Marcos regime in 1977. I might say that Dr. Guzman and I have had the same occupational hazards. I think in the case of Dr. De Guzman, he underwent the same difficulties when he was arrested. It is a kind of torture to be subjected to the rough methods of arrest and incarceration, the solitary confinement, and other forms of psychological torture. Amidst the so-called integration of the entire world under the unquestionably or seemingly unquestionable hegemony of the United States, there are these revolutionary movements now in Peru and the Philippines demonstrating to the world that it is possible to fight imperialism and the reactionaries.
The third delegation went to Lima at the end of November 1992.
Now, we four were able to get into that country and get out again with some pretty fresh and pretty damning evidence about the situation of human rights, the situation of political prisoners, and the situation of the revolutionary political prisoners, including Presidente Gonzalo, and the lawyers involved, sort of repression that they're facing. Now, the lawyers in Peru that are defending these political prisoners have literally laid their lives on the line.
On January 11, the lawyer Dr. Alfredo Crespo was arrested in Lima. His crime, defending Dr. Guzman. He was charged with treason and is now serving a life sentence. Dr. Crespo was president of the Association of Democratic Lawyers, a group whose members have been persecuted and murdered. Dr. Jorge Cartagena, another member, was arrested along with Dr. Crespo and is also serving a life sentence. Lawyers from all over the world have sent letters to Fujimori protesting the persecution of lawyers in Peru.
Y como quiero denunciar, pues él ha sido detenido por órdenes superiores, por haber asumido la defensa, especialmente del señor Abimael Guzmán, porque él era un abogado que se desempeñaba como cualquier otro abogado. Y como digo, asumía la defensa pues de los que iban a contratar su servicio, en este caso eran obreros, campesinos, estudiantes. Y porque tampoco no era un abogado que cobraba pues sumas exorbitantes o se ha lucrado pues del sufrimiento del pueblo.
Sí.
¿Y está orgullosa?
Orgullosa, claro, pero que no se rinda. Prefiero que lo maten. Una maldita soy yo. Que se rebelde contra este chino maldito, prefiero la muerte en mí. Yo tengo un carácter terrible.
The big human rights organizations, such as Amnesty International, have done nothing positive concerning Dr. Guzman. They talk about human rights, but they oppose the rights of the people to rise up against their oppressors and make revolution. They put the oppressed and the oppressors on an equal footing. In protest of Amnesty's policies, thousands of postcards were sent to their London office. In January, the IEC in Turkey hosted a tour of IEC delegates Anne-Marie Parodi, a lawyer from Paris, and Rajib Sarakolu, a journalist and former political prisoner in Turkey. Hundreds attended meetings in Adana, Izmir, Gaziantep, and Istanbul. Human rights lawyers also spoke, and the meetings were covered on TV. In February, the South Asia Regional Conference to defend the life of Dr. Abimael Guzman was held in Kathmandu, Nepal. A demonstration was also held. In late February, nearly 1,000 people from over 33 countries attended the IEC founding conference in Germany. People traveled from every continent. Many took great risks crossing borders to come. One of the Turkish delegates, a lawyer, Metin Can, was killed by a death squad just before leaving Turkey.
Tomorrow we have to sit down and ponder plans for the future of the campaign.
Yeah. Delegates from across the world spoke to the conference.
My name is Mary Cox. I'm an attorney and a writer from Washington, D.C. I visited Peru on the third delegation back in November of 1992 because in the United States, not very many people know about Dr. Guzman and his work. And when I learned about this man's great works and what Shining Path was doing to liberate Peru and the world, I felt it necessary to inform African people in the United States and the world over about what I believe to be the greatest people's popular movement in the world. Thank you for allowing me to share this podium with the most esteemed people and be with you, and I will go back to the United States, or they say United States of America.
A steering committee for IEC was elected and resolutions were passed. Against the Fujimori dictatorship, US hands off Dr. Guzman, Yankee go home. Amnesty International must act and expand the campaign further in Latin America. On April 3, 1993, Dr. Guzman was transferred to a newly constructed cell at Callao Naval Base. The 4th IEC delegation arrived in Lima right at this time. For the first time, the Lima press was forced to print sections of the IEC call, as well as some of the internationally prominent signatories such as Ramsey Clark, Sinead O'Connor, and the many members of parliament from different countries. The 4th delegation was invited to visit some shanty towns.
We have been very well received for people in the shanty town, mm-hmm. and we have seen how they are living in the sense of food making, for example. They are very, very poor people, and in this shanty town they have 12 kitchens, but common kitchens. They call it olla común. You can see, even in the air, the solidarity these people have between themselves. That's why I shall remember forever my two friends of North America, because they were starting to cry, and their tears, I have seen their tears. Yeah, they were explaining to us, to the Peruvian friends in the shantytown and to me, that they compare the ambience, the human behavior in New York and in this shantytown. They told us in New York everything is money and money and money, and in this shanty town people is having solidarity and helping each other, and that's the future, that's our hope for the future of this world.
The shanty town residents presented a statement to the delegation. We want your very important delegation to tell the world what you have seen here. The government of Peru can put our leader, Chairman Gonzalo, underground. But the Communist Party of Peru has not fallen, and the people's war will be successful in the end. Viva el Presidente Gonzalo! Defend the life of Dr. Abimael Guzman! On May 1st, democratic lawyers in Lima submitted 3 petitions with the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, which is part of the Organization of American States, or OAS. In their petitions, they exposed the treatment of Dr. Guzman and the brutal detention of other political prisoners and the persecution of the lawyers in Peru. 2 U.S. lawyers, Peter Erlinder and Leonard Weinglass, argued on behalf of the Lima lawyers' petitions at a hearing in Washington, D.C. in October. Support for the legal case has come from around the world.
Action by the government of Peru in closing down its parliament and in reinstating the death penalty shows how far Peru has to go. The world is watching Peru to see how it passes all these tests, whether it accepts Lenin's wine glass to represent Dr. Gutzmann, and whether he receives a fair trial will be the first of these tests. We are watching very closely.
IC International Days of Actions were held on May 14 and 15 in dozens of countries.
Organizó una protesta en contra del presidente Fujimori cuando este visitó la Universidad de Berkeley en los Estados Unidos el año pasado. Aquella vez, algunos peruanos acudieron.
You are very important to me. Please listen. I want your son. I want your husband. I want your daughter. I want your nephew. I want your niece. The future is very tenuous. These people have been fighting me for 12 years. They now claim they control 60% of Peru. They are like the fish in the ocean. We cannot find them.
Public enemy number one in Peru facing execution.
Being a revolutionary is no crime. So why is Gonzalo doing time?
Inside his life is on the line.
Fujimori ain't nothing but slime.
They accuse Gonzalo of treason.
In Mexico, 700 people demonstrated at the Peruvian and U.S. embassies. In Bolivia, a large banner hung from a university building. The campaign was taken to Ecuador and to a youth conference in Venezuela. Videos were shown on the streets of Hamburg, Germany. There was a demonstration at the National Press Club in Bangladesh where a U.S. flag was burned. Banners greeted downtown shoppers in Switzerland. In Colombia, artists set up scaffolding to paint a huge mural. And in Lima itself, the slogan "Victory to the International Days of Action, May 14 and 15" was seen on shantytown walls. In June, IC raised controversy and support at the International Human Rights Conference in Vienna, sponsored by the UN. Perú TV reported.
Una de esas organizaciones apoya al cabecilla de Sendero Luminoso, Abimael Guzmán, y lo hace seguramente sin conocer su ideología y su trayectoria delictiva.
From September 12 to 24, 1 year after the capture, Dr. Guzman's speech was again heard across the world. They were burning tires in the streets of Germany. A banner flew high above the Mexican-US border control. Workers at a factory in Turkey went on a one-day strike in solidarity with Dr. Guzman. 1 year after the capture, the campaign continued to grow.
Messi Abimael, Messi.
Libele, 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 libele
I see literature in many different languages, t-shirts and badges were distributed worldwide. The revolutionary organization of the political prisoners and the prisoners of war in Peru has become famous around the world.
A vista de pájaro parece una maqueta. La prisión de máxima seguridad de Canto Grande está situada en pleno desierto de Lima, entre barrios de miseria. En Canto Grande viven 500 senderistas acusados de terrorismo. La retórica y la disciplina maoísta han convertido estos pabellones en el último frente de la gloriosa trinchera revolucionaria. Los internos se consideran prisioneros de guerra. Rechazan la comida, las medicinas, porque creen que el Estado quiere aniquilarlos. El partido, nadie sabe cómo, les proporciona de todo.
Footage was taken at Canto Grande before the government killed nearly 100 prisoners in the May 1992 massacre. Today, conditions are much worse, but the political prisoners continue to contribute to the revolution. These artworks were made by the political prisoners out of bone and coin and shell. They were smuggled out of the prisons and given to the IC by people from Peru to support the campaign. Dr. Abimael Guzmán is still in prison on a life sentence. From the beginning, the regime repeatedly stated they wanted to kill him. Up to now, the continuing people's war, as well as the international campaign, has prevented this. But Dr. Guzmán's life remains in danger. Fujimori's own decrees limit solitary confinement to 1 year. But Dr. Guzman's lawyers, doctors and family have still not been allowed to visit him since October 7, 1992. The 5th IEC delegation came to Lima in October 1993 and the international lawyers demanded again to visit Dr. Guzman. Fujimori actually went on TV to refuse them by name. The lawyers continue to fight for this visit and are working with the democratic lawyers in Lima.
Voy caminando sobre la nieve. Junto al río de Montero, voy caminando sobre la nieve. Por senderos luminosos.
The U.S. ruler says that the movement led by the Communist Party of Peru represents the greatest threat to U.S. domination of Peru and all of Latin America. But no one has been able to stop this powerful people's war. and they cannot silence the millions of people around the world who stand with Dr. Guzman and the struggling people of Peru.
Combatiente guerrillero, todo corazón que su espacio estardas, rendirme como en los Andes, está floreciendo la guerra popular. Se ve la bandera en la cumbre, señalando rumbo al nuevo Perú. El mundo de la voz y el martillo, con el presidente Gonzalo y su luz. Con el presidente Gonzalo y su luz. Con el viejo orden el sol ya se apaga, con una aurora lo enterrará. Lo que con su sangre el surco regaron, la nueva semilla cosechando está. El viejo norte y el sol ya se apaga, el aurora lo enterrará. Lo que con su sangre el surco regaron, la nueva semilla cosechando está. La nueva semilla cosechando está.